Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Welcome to Course 5A of the Monique and Roland Vale People's Academy of International Law. I am Marjorie Cohn, Dean of the People's Academy, and a member of the Bureau of the International Association of Democratic Lawyers. As we approach the one-year anniversary of Israel's genocidal campaign in Gaza and the occupied West Bank, including East Jerusalem, we reconvene after our summer break. Our topic for today is individual and collective human rights and challenges to their realization. Our faculty for this course includes Curtis Dobler, Andrew Reed, and Bill Bowring. Each of them will speak for about 40 minutes. They will then comment on each other's presentations, followed by Q&A with the registrants. We have French, Spanish, and English translation. Please put your questions in the Q&A box for our discussion. In the next few days, we will post on our website, peoplesacademy.net, the faculty presentations in English, French, and Spanish, along with links to relevant articles. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is considered customary international law, was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in 1948. It guaranteed two different sets of human rights, civil and political rights on the one hand, and economic, social, and cultural rights on the other. These two types of human rights were codified into binding treaties which entered into force in 1976. They are the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, or the ICCPR, and the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, or the ICESCR. Today, our faculty will discuss these human rights and contrast individual human rights and collective human rights. They will also examine the absence of effective remedies for violations of human rights. Curtis Dobler is research professor of law in the Department of Law at the University of Makeni in Sierra Leone. He is also proprietor of the law office of Dr. Curtis F.J. Dobler in San Antonio, Texas, in the United States of America, which provides pro bono representation of individuals and groups in cases involving human rights. He also advises governmental, non-governmental, and intergovernmental entities on public international law. Curtis's publications include The Dictionary of Public International Law, published in the US by Roman and Littlefield, and International Human Rights Law, Cases and Materials, published by the Tashkent State Institute of Law in Uzbekistan and CD Publishing in India. Curtis will discuss the history of international human rights law, the interests underlying individual and collective rights, and testing the integrity of the human rights system. Andrew Reed is a lifelong social and eco-justice advocate, an author, and an adjunct professor of law in the Human Rights Program at the University of Denver in Colorado in the United States, where he teaches courses on the international human rights law of indigenous peoples, federal Indian law, and environmental ethics and justice. Over the past 40 years, he has worked with and provided legal counsel to many environmental organizations and Native nations and treaty councils and organizations. Andy's trial and appellate practice established legal precedent to protect human and constitutional rights, Native rights, environmental justice, and other areas of law. He regularly participates in international conferences and fora on earth and indigenous issues, and is currently legal counsel and an expert in matters before the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. Andy is a graduate of the University of Oklahoma, where he received his BA, BLS, and JD. the University of Denver's Sturm College of Law, where he received his LLM, and Eugene Dupuc Law School in the Bahamas, where he received an LEC in British Common Law. Andy will address the collective human rights of peoples, especially indigenous peoples, the evolution of human rights, the three generations of human rights, and securing remedies in the inter-American system. Professor Bill Bowring has taught human rights and international law at Birkbeck College at the University of London since 2006. He entered academia in 1990. A practicing barrister since 1974, Bill has represented applicants at the European Court of Human Rights since 1992, especially against Turkey and Russia. He has acted as a consultant and expert for the United Nations, the Council of Europe, the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, OSCE, the European Union, and the UK government. Bill has more than 150 publications, including monographs, edited collections, chapters, and articles. His first monograph, The Degradation of the International Legal Order, The Rehabilitation of Law and the Possibility of Politics, published in 2008 by Routledge, has been translated into Russia by NLO Publishers in 2021. His second monograph is Law, Rights, and Ideology in Russia, Landmarks in the Destiny of a Great Power, published by Routledge in 2013. In 2017, he was awarded a fellowship of the Academy of Social Sciences, FACSS, for his work on Russia. Bill will provide a Marxist approach to international human rights law, focusing particularly on the two covenants, the ICCPR and the ICESCR. Our first presenter is Curtis. Curtis?
Okay, use this fully PowerPoint. Hope you all see that. What I want to look at, as was indicated, is international human rights law, individual and collective rights in their context. And by that, I mean a sort of critical look at international human rights law. Of course, this will be a very brief look and a very selective look, but I hope it gives a bit of an introduction to this. And I think that many of the things I touch on will be taken further by our other speakers who have perhaps more detailed substance to present. Let's see. Right, this to go to the next one. So I'll try to make this presentation in three parts. First, by just pointing out some history. Some of it will repeat what Marjorie just said. Then looking at, but doing it with some critical remarks on the history, again, a selective history, but with these critical remarks. Then I'll try to point out again, critically, some of the interest that individual and collective rights have been, that have been behind individual and collective rights, I guess some, in some ways where they come from. And last, I want to point out, which perhaps is for me the most meaningful part of this short presentation, you know, what might be the test that we need, or the signposts we need to look at, what I call the test of integrity, for international human rights law. In other words, what should we look at, or at least two of the instances, there are many more, but I just selected two, something related to climate change and related to genocide, one of the most serious violations of human rights. What should we look at to see if this system is working? Because I think for all of us, human rights is not merely a academic endeavor, it's something that I know certainly the other three people involved in this presentation today, it's something that we hope will have meaning to individuals, to victims of human rights violations. And I look at two examples that I think will give us an understanding of whether or not that is the case. And I try to point out who might be looking to determine that. Remembering that human rights is part of public international law, that still today, although that is changing to some degree, is still a state-dominated domain. So some of the history of human rights, then let's start with just looking at the traditional history, but before that, some questions about the origin of human rights. I hope you'll keep in mind as I go through the whole presentation. And the first is, where did international human rights come from? That's in some ways a trick question, because I don't think we really have an answer to it, but we do have certain suppositions, people suggesting where human rights have arisen. Lawyers seem to take perhaps a very dogmatic view about it, in that we have international human rights treaties that provide for legal substance to those rights, or legal obligations, as international law calls them, that have those rights, international human rights, in them. And we also have some instruments, one that was already mentioned by Marjorie in the introduction, such as the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as I'll mention in a minute, that has some expression of those rights. But we should not also forget, which I'll come back to in a second, that there are emerging forms right now that are suggesting that there are other bases for these rights, such as the thinking and the views of indigenous people. And some of the, of course, we've always had the Western tradition of human rights has emanated from the Enlightenment and the natural rights doctrine. But there are now doctrines that existed at that same time, or thinking about the rights of human beings that exist at the same time. And I'll look at a few of those. But think about that. One of the questions I hope to at least raise, maybe more sub-questions about, is where did international human rights come from? Do those rights reflect universal priorities? In other words, does international human rights law really reflect universal priorities? This was a debate I had with one of my first law professors, Myers McDougall, who was one of the more prominent international lawyers in the United States, and two with a sociologist, Harold Laswell, political scientist, Harold Laswell, put together a quite interesting and what I thought scientifically valuable structure for trying to understand the law. But that began with a assumption of values that were based on very much a cultural perspective from which he came, which both of them came, they're both Americans. So think a little bit about, does international law, I hope particularly any of you who are watching this, participating in this presentation, you think a little bit about, does your culture, the history of your country, the history of your culture, is it reflected adequately in the priorities of that culture or nationality or ethnicity? Is it reflected adequately in international human rights law? Remembering that our standards, or what I'll call maybe traditional international human rights law, is based very much on Western European and American values. And lastly, is international human rights law working? And that I try to address, certainly not in a definitive way, but in a more inquisitive way, I try to address with looking at a couple examples of, and not really giving an answer, but proposing what might be the answer, depending on how the international community, particularly the international community of states, deals with some international problems that international human rights law is certainly concerned with. So the traditional understanding of international human rights law, which you'll read in most Western European and really most textbooks that are available right now on international human rights law, with some exceptions in Asia and in few exceptions in Africa. My course book, which I am an American national, I also have Palestinian and Dutch nationality, or should say had Dutch nationality, as you lose it if you don't live in Holland for 8 years. But I still studied law in Europe and in the United States. So I come very much from that perspective. Although my course book was one of the leading course books in Africa for a time when I was them teaching there, but it's a bit old now, that course book. But it was because there were not a lot of course books available from African publishers. Now that is changing significantly, but still the majority of our views on international law come from a Western dominated perspective, and our traditional understandings of international human rights law come from that. You'll often read about the Magna Carta, the American and French Declarations of Human Rights, the American Declaration of Independence, if you will, and the French Declaration on the Rights of Man. Those are instruments that are often cited in the Western European tradition as the basis of international human rights law. Also, we talk about after the First World War, the advent, sometimes even in between that, the Red Cross movement from the middle of the 1800s, 1863, and the first Red Cross conventions, not the ones we have today, the Geneva Conventions, but the first Geneva Conventions that date back to 1863, and the Red Cross movement that was founded by Henri Dunant. But remember, during all of these instruments, slavery was widely practiced by Western European states, and the subjects of that slavery often came from Africa or South America. So these instruments, although put forward as the foundation of our traditional understanding of international human rights, are not always without their shortcomings, for sure, or at least the shortcomings of the context in which they arose. Similarly, with the minority rights and the Versailles Treaty, the Versailles Treaty did not include any human rights, although it did include the, in part one of that, the Covenant of the League of Nations. But the Covenant of the League of Nations did include a dispute mechanism. There are several dispute mechanisms or processes by which disputes could be decided. And the minority treaties signed among mainly European states included minority rights that could be essentially adjudicated or decided, because those were not always adjudicatory bodies under the Versailles Treaty. But minority rights, so the rights of minorities in European countries that could be adjudicated, that was one of probably the first legal restrictions on the sovereignty of states, that they had to respect some minority rights after the First World War. And of course, the Versailles Treaty included in Part 13 the rights or the creation of an international labor organization that later became the International Labor Organization, now a UN specialized agency. Then that included, of course, references to workers' rights, but they were not very well drawn out in the Versailles Treaty in Part 13, which really refers to the institutional capacity, the constitutional, if you will, understanding of the ILO. But our human rights system, if you look at most course books, although they'll make nods to earlier expressions and even other cultures' expressions of human rights, as we'll come to, it mainly emanates from the advent of the United Nations system of human rights and some of the regional systems. And you see there a list of treaties. I'll just very quickly go through some of the abbreviations there. The first is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The second, which I'll come back again to, is the GC, is the Genocide Convention, which came after World War II. And all of these instruments emanate from after World War II. So not from the League of Nations that we talked about just a minute ago, but from the United Nations. The Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, the two treaties that you already heard about, the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, the International Covenant on Economic, Social, on Civil and Political Rights, the CEDAW Convention, the Convention on Discrimination, the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, CAT, the Convention Against Torture, a Convention on the Rights of the Child, and the CMW is the Convention on the Rights of Migrant Workers, all migrant workers and their families, and the Convention on Enforced Disappearances, CED, and CRPD is the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. These are the nine principal United Nations conventions, with the Genocide Convention added, and the Universal Declaration there in parentheses, because it is not a legally binding document, but as you heard, it is reflects customary international law that most states have agreed to. Not the whole Universal Declaration, I should caution, but I would say the majority of the provisions in it reflect customary international law as adopted by states. The regional human rights systems also evolved during this time, and those include the Inter-American system, which two of the instruments abbreviated there, the American Declaration on the Rights and Duties of Man from 1948, and then if you skip the European Convention, the American Convention on Human Rights. There. The American Declaration of Rights and Duties of Man is important for those of you in the United States, because that is the only, it's not a legally binding instrument, although there's discussion about that, but it is a declaration, so a declaratory instrument like the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, that can be applied to the United States. And in my view, it's applied as reflecting customary international law. The Inter-American Commission on Human Rights that applies it, it says that it's binding, but I think by understanding it to reflect customary international law. The ECHR is the European Convention on Human Rights, and the ECHPR is the African Charter on Human and People's Rights that I'll come back to. And I want to just point out also that there are other human rights systems. There are other systems that have provided for the protection of human rights. Among those are the OIC, that has a commission on human rights and has promulgated a declaration related to the Permanent Commission on Human Rights. The CIS, the Commonwealth of Independent States, that includes Russia, which is now withdrawn from the Council of Europe. So it is now the only human rights instrument that binds Russia going forward, is the Commonwealth of Independent States Convention on Human Rights. There's also an Islamic Declaration on Human Rights promulgated by non-state actors. And in the Asian context, the context of Asian and Southeast Asian nations, there is a Permanent Commission on Human Rights. And there are instruments that have promulgated provisions on human rights. And in the League of Arab States, or under its auspices, there is the Arab Charter on Human Rights. These other regional human rights systems have been criticized for weak implementation mechanisms, but maybe it's just a different type of implementation that perhaps we'll understand as I go forward. I also wanted to point out some new instruments that are being developed as we talk. There is a treaty on the right to development that has now been sent to the General Assembly, and hopefully the text will be adopted and opened for ratification by states as a treaty providing for the right to development, both as a human right and as a right between states, so more part of general public international law. And there is a treaty being negotiated where the text has not yet been adopted on businesses or transnational corporations and their obligations under international human rights law, which is an interesting development to hold non-state actors responsible for the protection of human rights. We have non-binding instruments at the moment, but not a legally binding instrument that does that. And lastly, there are instruments such as the Declaration on the Rights of Mother Earth that have been developed. It's still, I would say, lege ferenda. It is developing law. But we'll see that maybe that reflects the views of new actors that are being involved in promulgating the law. Let's move on here a little bit. But I want to, those, what I just described is a traditional understanding of the development of international human rights law through international human rights instruments, both legally binding instruments, treaties that form legal obligations, and declarations that create the suggestion of obligations, if you will, that can become legally binding obligations because they have been adopted by state practice and opinio juris of states, the fact the states are acting in the belief that they are legal obligations. But there are other alternative understandings starting from the beginning of where international human rights or human rights evolved from. Probably one of the first is the Mandean Charter, part that was an instrument that was promulgated by Sindhita Kita, of the Malian Empire, the emperor of the Malian Empire in 1222, around 1200, which is long before most of the other instruments except the Magna Carta. And although it was as imperfect as the others, it was in a society in which there was slavery prevalent, where women did not participate fully, it did promulgate some rights and protections for women and children and slaves. It limited, in other words, the sovereign's authority over individual freedoms, but it also indicated that individuals were subject to the good of the whole. So think about that. The indigenous concept of rights, which range from the concept of collective rights, or Ubuntu as is known in Africa, which means the individual's meaning is within the context of the community, to the rights of Mother Earth, are concepts that originate in indigenous thinking, and I'm sure my colleague will have more to say about that, but originate in indigenous thinking, but are now being put forward as the basis for at least lege ferenda, and perhaps a basis, or the basis, I would suggest, for some of the lex lata, what has entered into law, particularly in instruments emanating from the African context. And in Asia, there has been a lot of attention to the situational uniqueness, sometimes called cultural relativity, of the Asian countries that were reflected in their history of struggle against colonialism. Now, certainly in Africa, that is part of the history of the African people, but it is something that has also been very much reflected in the culture of the African, of the Asian peoples, and in some of their instruments relating to human rights. It has also suggested the necessity to cooperate to try to ensure respect for human rights instead of adhering to legally binding or not so much instruments as well as institutions that can enforce the law. So the concept of enforcement of law through legal institutions is something that is not as prevalent in the Asian understanding of human rights as it is in the Western European and American. And I say that without any judgment on which might be the more effective, because again, I think we all would agree that the importance of human rights is to have the effect of protecting individuals or collective entities. And you see from these examples there, which are part of colonial history, that there has often been in other cultures, there has often been a greater reliance on the collectivity, on the community, which means also a greater reliance on not only individual rights, but as even individuals having rights because they are part of the community and on the community's rights in relation to other communities, something which we don't always think about as human rights in the Western perspective. Well, these are some of the understandings of human rights. Let me look very quickly then at what we're talking about here when we talk about individual and collective rights. Individual rights are reflected, as I've already mentioned, in the United Nations and Inter-American and European instruments primarily. These instruments start with, or not start with, actually, we'll see that in a minute, but they reflect very much a natural rights or liberal approach to human rights, meaning that the individual is the center or the end, as Kant might put it, of the freedoms that we enjoy. And the liberal tradition, some of the writers I've cited there, that's who those names refer to, it reflects the understanding that human rights are freedoms from state interference, something that is very much linked to capitalism and the understanding of a capitalist society in which individuals are free to interact with each other in maybe mainly it refers to economic interaction, but it refers more widely, the liberal tradition, to this type of interaction without interference of the state. Now, that is in conflict, if you will, to the understanding that we'll come to when we look collective rights. Individual rights, in other words, what this slide is intended to stress, they are rights that reflect the protection of the individual from state interference. Collective rights, on the other hand, which are reflected more in some of the instruments of the societies I've just indicated, particularly I want to focus on the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, they reflect more this concept of Ubuntu that I've already mentioned, and community or selfness, selflessness, which means the individual's value, again, to repeat what I've said before, is part of their value to the community. This is the, if you will, the understanding of collective rights. Well, what do we mean by collective rights? Some of these rights we find in the traditional instruments, such as the right, which is the first right mentioned in the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights and the International Covenant of Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, the rights to self-determination, which is a right of peoples, a right that can be enjoyed only by a person who is part of a collective of a person. We're not talking about, as you sometimes hear in the United States, about self-determination being the ability of an individual to determine their own way in life. We're talking more about a collective right when we talk about the right to self-determination. It is a right of peoples, not of an individual, but of peoples. It is also one of the rights which has not been found to be able to be implemented by, for example, the Human Rights Committee under the ICCPR, although it is a right that is in that treaty. It is certainly a right in the African instruments, but the African Charter on Human and People's Rights goes further. It includes not only the right to self-determination, but the right to be able to enjoy the fruits of the labor of the community, or I should say the natural resources, the exploitation of the natural resources of the community. You see an example of this in the cases brought, several of them actually brought before the African Commission, before even the local courts in the Netherlands, by the Ogoni people living in the Niger Delta of Nigeria. That is an oil-rich area that the Nigerian government has allowed foreign oil companies to exploit. And those foreign oil companies have done that exploitation with damage to the environment and even to some individuals, literally killing some individuals, but through their activities in those areas of the Niger Delta in Nigeria. But those people have a right to enjoy, the people who live in that area, the Ogoni people, have a right to enjoy the benefits of the exploitation of the natural resources. It might be something they have to share also with others in the national context of Nigeria, but they cannot be excluded from the enjoyment of those benefits, which means also they must be protected from the harm done in the acquisition of the financial benefits that are achieved from the exploitation of oil in that area. And this is not my view. This is, of course, the view of the African Commission on Human and People's Rights applying the law in the African Charter on Human and People's Rights in a case brought by the Center for Economic Rights, I believe. I'm not sure if that is the name, but against Nigeria. It was one of the most notable cases for the application of economic and social rights, but it is also notable for the application of those rights to peoples. So this right not to be exploited, they also found a violation of the right to self-determination of these people because it destroyed their culture and did not allow them to maintain the communities they had, and the right to development because it stunted their development by the exploitation of their natural resources in a way that essentially harmed them rather than and promoted their development. So the concept of collective rights, and not only in Africa, but primarily, I would suggest, in Africa, Asia, and among more popular now among the indigenous communities in nations in South America, these are rights that subject the interest of the individual to the interest of the collective whole. And that's something that I think Bill perhaps will talk about in reflecting on a Marxist approach to international human rights law that reflects the concern about not only the individual, but also the structures of society that disadvantage, I would suggest, not only individuals, but also collectivities. And this just rehashes some of what I said, but because I'm late in time, I'm just going to go through two very quickly, if I may, two examples of what I call tests of whether or not our human rights system is working, given what I just said, in a somewhat critical view of our human rights, although more perhaps neutral. I want to now be a little bit more critical and just look at some things that are reflect both individual rights and collective rights. And the first is the, if you will, problem of climate change. And the question that I suggest is a test of the integrity of our system of human rights and the current division, which favors individual rights, but really whether either the collective or individual rights system works, is can we protect human and people's rights from the adverse effects of climate change? And you might think this is a fairly straightforward question, and the answer probably should be straightforward, that we should protect human and people's rights from the adverse effects of climate change. But it has not been so easy to answer this, and the UNFCCC, particularly the Paris Agreement, really has failed to provide a mechanism for protecting these rights. And to date, although this is changing, and I'm sure some of my colleagues will indicate, before the Inter-American Commission, for example, I was participated in a hearing where the Inter-American Commission is going to make a give an advisory opinion on, in the Inter-American system, how human rights are protected in the context of climate change. And the second example that I want to look at is so that in the first example, it will be a test of whether or not our international human rights treaties, and I suggest that we watch to see whether the instruments and whether the bodies that implement these treaties, not only in the human rights realm, but also in the climate change realm, are able to effectively protect human and people's rights and protect human beings and peoples from the adverse effects of climate change. And the second test that I want to suggest relates to genocide, which is probably one of the most serious violations of human rights that one could even conceptualize. It is one only conceptualized after World War II as a threatening of a people's very existence. It is a crime, an international crime, but also a prohibition under international human rights law in the Genocide Convention and in the ICC, the International Criminal Court statute. But it is a prohibition of the intentional destruction through killing, creating conditions of life, or creating means to prevent births of children in a particular population. It is an attack on a particular religious, national, or ethnic population. I think that the majority of lawyers today, as we've heard already in other of the presentations previous to today, in this from the People's University, agree that genocide is taking place in Palestine. I have argued that for several decades, that the genocide has been taking place going back for more than 100 years, first by Zionist entities, and secondly by, and now by the state of Israel and particular actors within that state. But I would suggest that, and this, that whether or not we can end the genocide in Palestine will be one of the primary tests of the integrity of international human rights law. And I furthermore suggest it's not my understanding of it, but we see that right now. We see that among the BRICS countries. We see that among most of the developing countries, for example, the G77 in China. They view as a test of the integrity of international law whether or not the international community, in other words, really what they're saying, the developed states of the North are going to take action to end the genocide in Palestine. And they view it as a test because it doesn't only require actual action by those states to intervene, but it requires, in many cases, in most cases, sufficient action would be merely to stop participating in the genocide, to stop supporting it, to stop providing the arms. So with that, I think I'm going to stop because I've taken already sufficient time, I believe, and hopefully you'll be able to discuss more in the questions. But I hope that rather than provide you information, I've raised some questions among those of you who are participating in this.
Well, thank you so much, Curtis, for providing a history of the international and regional and other human rights systems, the distinction and explanation of individual and collective human rights, and the test of the human rights system, particularly in the area of climate change and genocide. Thank you so much for that. Next, Andy.
I'm going to do my presentation from the point of a practitioner. I teach in this area as well, but my heart and soul is in the practice of international law as a tool for social justice. Next slide. The my primary work is with indigenous peoples, and I found for many years, for some 3 or 4 decades, I practiced the domestic law of indigenous peoples. Here in the United States, we call that federal Indian law. And but I found we had to endure the limitations of that. It's essentially colonial law. And about 10 or 15 years ago, we came to the realization that the real advocacy for the rights of indigenous peoples is at the international level because of its a colonial relationship. In doing that, I want to develop a little bit of background on how we approach this as a practitioner. It's important, and I think Curtis went through some of this, or most of this, and I'll try not to repeat what he said, but there is a concept of the evolution of human rights. Next slide. The first generation had those two parts to it. One is the civil concepts of civil rights. We see that in our Bill of Rights for the U.S. Constitution. These are individual, we call them individual rights, but they're actually restrictions on government conduct. And then the second pertain to empowerments or liberty. And you'll see there on the slide on the right, there's a reference to it being a Western concept. I work with indigenous peoples, and they really don't have this concept. So even within human rights law, it's a Western development of Western law. It came out of the liberal states of Europe, and particularly the England and the United, and then later on through the United States. That's found to be useful for Native people, but it's not an indigenous concept. Native people speak in terms of relationships and not rights. And so this whole concept of rights is somewhat foreign, but we've been able, for those of us that represent indigenous communities, we found it useful. Next slide. So the you'll see both concepts of this, of the first generation of human rights found in the Universal Declaration. Next slide. I will say that the Universal Declaration, as we all know, if you study the history of it, was basically written, although it's a global document, was authored in large part by the United States, trying to impose liberal civil rights concepts upon the world to promote the Western democracies that would facilitate capitalism and private property. A second generation of rights, which is known as more positive rights, you see those in the various human rights documents, next slide, such as those on economic, social, and cultural rights, civil and political rights, and the elimination of racial discrimination. Those are rights that are, human rights that are still expressed essentially as individual rights, but they arise out of a collective relationship, like a status, that you're a member of what we acknowledge as race. Although race is a social construct, but you belong to a politic, a civil society, or a social group. Next slide. So until the third generation of human rights, it was generally spoken of as individual rights. Even if they were collective rights, they were expressed through individuals. In the 60s and 70s, then we started to get this concept of collective rights. Collective rights are not recognized generally recognized, certainly human rights aren't, within U.S. law, but it's being more generally accepted and adopted in the domestic laws of other nations around the world. The collective rights might include the right of self-determination, the right to a language, right to nationality, right to culture, right to spirituality can be a collective right, and so forth. Next slide. So the third generation of human rights is generally being expressed as collective rights, which came about late 1970s, which are being expressed by the human rights treaties on social and cultural rights, the elimination of racial discrimination, and civil and political rights. Next slide. Can you go back to that previous slide? There was one thing I wanted to mention. There's collective rights, and I disagree with this mostly as a practitioner, but it's formed my understandings as a academician, that collective rights, as they've been described in most human rights textbooks, we'll talk about them as being two subtypes. One is the what I would call group rights, and these are rights of people. That are, for example, unions and status groups, women, children, so for the rights of people. And that's one subtype. The other subtype is the right of peoples, and that's with the S on the end of it. And I would make the argument that the rights of peoples are basically a third generation of the evolution of human rights, because they are so distinct and substantially different than the rights of groups. The rights of peoples, for example, would include, I'll get to that in a minute. Next slide. So we have the first subtype is the rights of groups. And so you have rights as a member of a group, rights as a member of a union, rights as a member of a status, rights as a woman, or as a child, or a person with disabilities. You have rights that are recognized as members of that group. There are human rights that have developed around that. But there's also this issue as whether or not groups themselves have rights. Do unions have rights? Right? Do corporations have rights? Next slide. And so you'll see this, for example, unions for collective bargaining. We've had this recent decisions here in the United States where they've recognized corporations of actually having rights. Now, these are not human rights, but this is the concept that you could have a group of people that actually has rights that are greater than the group itself. In the United States, we had the recent decision of Citizen United, which recognized corporations as an artificial person, and therefore recognize that it had certain rights, which such as the right of equal protection, the right of due process. Now, equal protection and due process are also human rights. So the next level of that may be corporations actually arguing that they have human rights. Next slide. There's obviously a huge debate over this within the United States as to the status of corporations. Next slide. And so the group rights, you'll see the status rights, you'll see under the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the Convention on Disabilities, which you'll see on the right, and then the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. The United States, by the way, and many other countries are reluctant to recognize these collective rights. And so as a practitioner representing Native nations and peoples, we have to sometimes try to find a way to get around the failure of the states to recognize or adopt these collective rights. And that's one of the big struggles right now. There seems to be a general, and it's become customary in international law, a general understanding of the individual human rights as being enforceable, but there's been a large resistance on the universal adoption of collective human rights. Next slide. So you'll see these three generations here on human rights. And the first two are the I generation, and then the last one is the we. And so you have this a little bit of tug and play between the we and the I, and as a practitioner, you can use both. So for example, I have, there are situations where members of a Native community have brought human rights, actions for human rights, including genocide, under these as individual violations. But then there's also been a developing law where the indigenous peoples and nations themselves collectively as a group have brought those rights. Next slide. And so you'll see this balancing. And one of the issues here is when you have perhaps conflicts between the rights of the public and the rights of the individual, how do we balance that? Next slide. You'll see that in the United States, I'll give you some examples here. One of the contrasts is the death of affirmative action in the United States. And that was a situation, does not involve human rights, but I have it here for the dynamics of this balancing between the rights of the individual and the rights of the collective. And here we had, in the United States, we had a collective right law that guaranteed the rights of people that had a history of discrimination, suffering discrimination, such as people of color, women, people with disability, and so forth. That dynamic came, and then we also have under the U.S. Constitution the individual civil rights, and under the that situation, the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled that the individual rights under the Constitution trump, they overcome the collective rights of the group, because the United States law does not recognize collective rights. So you have the rights of one or two people that actually trump the rights of millions. Next slide. And you'll see that here where in the Citizens United case I just mentioned, where they have the rights of corporations, right? And this is a corporations that are done, even though they're a collection of stockholders or owners, they're considered to be people under the US Constitution, and they have a right of free speech. And that right of free speech is in effect trumping the rights of democracy, the rights of citizens, and outweighing their rights. Next slide. So you'll see that individual and collective dynamics there. I work in this area. It's called the law of peoples. And the S is important there. You have a collective a group of people without the S, and that would be the rights of groups. When groups of people have a certain character that defines them as peoples, then they have additional rights. Next slide. And so generally that would be, for example, a common history, a common language, a common location and territory, and oftentimes the governance and so forth. And once you're defined as a peoples, then you take on all of these additional rights, which the group actually itself did not have. I've been surprised there's actually very little written on the rights of peoples. There is a book by Professor Crawford here that I note. I would consider it the fourth generation, and it's this concept of the difference between a group of people versus peoples. Next slide. The Charter of the United States, and when this first arises, and this is obviously some time ago, 75 years ago, recognizes peoples, and they refer to peoples. They don't refer to people or a group of peoples. They refer to peoples with the S. And so it started this concept that certain groups of people have rights that are actually larger than the group. And in the charter itself, it says that all peoples and nations, large and small, are equal. They have this sense of equality among peoples. Next slide, please. So, and you'll see that in the also in the UN Charter, you'll see that when they talk about the peoples that have not yet attained a full measure of self-governance, and that is a sacred trust to assist them in developing. And here we're talking about a right of self-determination. Next slide. So one of the primary rights of Native peoples, peoples in general, and I'm not talking about Native peoples here, but peoples in general, is this concept of self-determination, which we find in the UN Charter and throughout most of the human rights documents. And the right of self-determination is defined as the right of all peoples to freely determine their political status and freely to pursue their economic, social, and cultural development. Next slide. So it's a fundamental human right, and it's a collective right. Groups of people do not have a right of self-determination, but peoples have a right of self-determination. That's expressed in a nation, creation of a nation. Next slide. And there you see where they share a common language and so forth. Nations share a territory, which then invokes a right of domain and the right of governance. Next slide. Which groups of people do not have, exercise the sovereignty over that domain. Next slide. And got a right of governance. Next slide. And right over your natural resources. So these, next slide. So these are all rights of peoples that groups of peoples do not possess. The other right that peoples have is the right to, and once they've formed a nation, is a right to engage in international relations, right? Next slide, which is needed in order to be defined as a state. Now, one of the early cases on this concept of peoples and what that means and the right of self-determination is the Western Sahara ICJ decision from 1975. And that dealt with the nomadic tribes of people that roamed the Western Sahara Desert engaged in a struggle for liberation. Both Morocco and Mauritania were claiming that territory as theirs, primarily Morocco. And so they got into a legal battle that was supposed to be settled by the ICJ in 1975. It's still going on. But it's if you read the decision, it's groundbreaking in terms of its employment of the concept of self-determination for peoples. And in this case, for the native peoples of the Western Sahara, they weren't organized as a nation. They didn't have a common governance. They weren't recognized so much as a nation. But what the court recognized, or what the opinion recognizes, is that because of their status as a peoples, with that S, as a peoples, that they had that it was their choice. They had the right of self-determination, so they could decide then freely whether or not to be part of Morocco, whether to be part of Mauritania, whether or not to be independent peoples and independent nation and form their own. And that was their choice and their decision and their right. So that's one instance where this concept of self-determination has been fleshed out for peoples. Next slide. You also see it more recently in the Chagos Islands ruling from 2019, which involved both Great Britain and the United States, as well as Mauritius. And so in that one, they invoked this right of self-determination in determining that the Chagos Islanders' rights to self-determination, as well as the right to pre-form consent, which is a right possessed of peoples as a national right in essence. Groups of people may have a right, for example, in the United States, they have a, what they call a right of consultation. But the right of consent is a right that's exercised by sovereign power. And so you'll see that as part of the development of human rights, collective human rights, is this right of consent. You'll see that in other documents as well. But this right of self-determination, it dealt with the colonial rule of the Chagos Islanders and resolving that. It was a recent ruling, excellent ruling, by the way. Next slide. One area that, one case that I think is and I'd encourage those that are here to read this case. It's a long case, and you can jump to the provisions that deal with this issue. But there are two Mabo cases. One is the Mabo 1 case, which I'm talking about now. There's a second Mabo 2 case that rejected the doctrine of discovery and established property rights of indigenous peoples under Australian law. This is a decision by the High Court of Australia. The reason why it's important for this discussion is that Australia has adopted and implemented the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. But they also have in their constitution a right, a civil right of property. So you had this interplay of individual right to property under the constitution, and it could be an individual right to property under the UN Declaration of Human Rights. So it's both a civil and a human rights concept. And then they adopted this international and implemented the international convention, which on racial discrimination. And where the conflict came about was that the Torres Strait Islanders in Northern Australia have a different concept of property than that's recognized under the Constitution of Australia. So you had a developer trying to exercise his individual right to property to develop the Torres Islands. And then you had the Torres Islanders that said, no, we don't recognize private property. We have a common ownership of property, a communal ownership of property. So you had this conflict between this native worldview of property that it cannot be owned privately by this developer, and it's owned in common among the Torres Islands people, and the individual right of the developer. And in this case, which was brought by a Torres Islanders named Mabo, they now have a Mabo Day in Australia. That's how important as the litigation was. But the court held that the international human rights law, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, actually took precedence over the private right. So it took the reverse position from that we saw with affirmative action in the United States on that dynamics. Next slide. So you have this concept of collective equality. So the Mabo case was not only a case involving property rights. So you had the property rights of the individual, but when you're talking about the property rights of peoples, right? They have a different kind of property rights, which was a communal property right. And this is in large part where I spend my time in working with indigenous peoples, because they have a different worldview. They have a communal concept of property. And what the Australian court looked at was, well, we have to give recognition to both sides. Otherwise, we're discriminating against the Torres Strait Islanders, against the indigenous peoples, because they were not recognizing their notion of property. And so the court then is not only a decision on property and the human and individual right to property, but it's also a decision on equality of peoples and nations, which we saw going back to the UN Charter. Next slide. See this again it's 2006 decision. That was by the UN Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. Now, the UN Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, I'll call it the UN CERD, was established in the International Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination to enforce the Human Rights Treaty. The United States has signed and ratified that treaty, as well most other nations of the world. And the Western Shoshone had their land that was taken by settlers under settler colonialism. In the United States, there are indigenous peoples in the area, Western United States. And so they lost in the domestic courts of the United States, the colonial courts. And so they brought an action with the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, which I'll discuss later, and won their case. And then that was brought by two individual members. So it's an example. The commission case is an example of two individuals exercising the rights of the collective. After that, then the tribe itself, the Western Shoshone, filed a petition with the UN CERT, saying that there are different dynamics, legal dynamics working here. The UN CERT is talking about racial and ethnic discrimination. So they had to file a petition that raised and put it within that context of racial discrimination. And so this is another situation now where we had this interplay between and whether or not the court is going to recognize the collective right to property as being discriminated against by the domestic power, here in the United States, by the colonial power. And they granted the petition and ruled in favor of the Western Shoshone, holding that federal Indian law, because of the way that it treats native property rights, violates their right of equal protection under the convention. Next slide. Then you have another example of this dynamics between individual and collective rights. You see them within the ILO, the International Labor Organization. The ILO was one of the first entities to actually adopt laws, international law that address the rights of indigenous peoples, of native peoples. And it's interesting because the ILO talks about not only indigenous peoples, but they talk about tribal peoples. And so tribal peoples would come within that separate concept of whether or not groups of people can actually have rights, because they were not considered to be indigenous peoples, because as tribal peoples, and there's a famous case called the Saramaka case, if the tribe was established after colonialism, then there was a question as to whether or not they could claim to be indigenous. And so they had a status of peoples with the S, but they weren't indigenous. So they were looking for other ways to protect their rights, even though they were not indigenous. So the Convention 107, which is on the left, which was adopted in the 1950s by the ILO, was during a period of assimilation. So they're looking at indigenous peoples and tribal peoples being protected in terms of their individual rights not to be discriminated against and not to be abused. And so it's really a civil rights approach, an individual rights approach. Then I believe it was in 1969 or 67, they had the convention on ILO Convention 169, which is one of the groundbreaking international law documents regarding the rights of indigenous peoples. And there they talk about both indigenous and tribal peoples. And there they talk about their land rights, the right of autonomy, the rights to essentially govern their own communities. So they're talking about people's rights here. The interesting part about ILO 169, though, is that after discussing all the rights of peoples and essentially saying that indigenous and tribal peoples have the same rights as other peoples, they insert a provision in there, which I'm sure was done by the colonial powers, that says the term peoples with the S that is used in the convention is not to be interpreted as the same as peoples under international law. So while they guaranteed or secured the rights, human rights of indigenous peoples to their land and territory and governance and so forth, they then created two sets of peoples, one indigenous and one non-indigenous, and it was a racial ethnic discrimination. So they actually violated the right to equal protection at the same time guaranteeing their other rights. So for a long time, for some 30, 40 years now, we had one group of peoples in the world that were the only peoples of the world, the indigenous peoples, that were denied the full rights of peoples. Next slide. And so the Saramaca case was the one I mentioned that invoked the ILO 169. Interesting thing about the Saramaca case is that Suriname had not signed on to, had not ratified or endorsed the ILO 169. So the Inter-American Commission had to find a way basically to bootstrap that in order to apply it in this situation. So, and I'll discuss how they do that here in a minute. Next slide. So my case, the one that I've most recently been working on before the commission is this one. It's the Onondaga Nation and the Haudenosaunee Confederacy against the United States. And it, next slide. It involves the, it's before the Organization of American States, next slide, which has set up the Inter-American Commission under the OAS Charter. They set up this body, tribunal, to decide human rights questions under the charter. Next slide. Now the Haudenosaunee territory is some 2 million acres. Next slide, of northern New York in the United States, along the Great Lakes, and they have a sacred lake there, the Onondaga Lake, that has been so contaminated now it's a Superfund site. Next slide. And so they brought claims before the Inter-American Commission under the American Declaration of the Rights and Duties of Man for the denial of equality, the denial of a right to fair trial, I would call it an effective remedy, and a denial of the right to property. These are all guarantees within the American Declaration of Rights and Duties of Man. Next slide. And this is we got a decision on admissibility, which came down 2023, so last year. And next slide. And they ruled that the United States had to respond to the illegal seizure of more than 2 million acres some 200 years ago. That was guaranteed by a treaty. Next slide. Now, how do we get there? And this is one thing that Curtis talked about a little bit, is the enforcement of this of the American Declaration. And this would be the same for the Universal Declaration as well. The declarations are not enforceable treaties. They are declarations. And so what role do they have? How do you get there? If you read my case and you read some of the other decisions, there's now a dozen or so of them involving indigenous peoples in the Inter-American Commission and some in the Inter-American Court on Human Rights. If you read those decisions, you have the situation where most of these colonial states have refused to sign the American Convention and adopt and implement the Inter-American Commission, the American Convention on Human Rights, or any of the other human rights treaties. There's a number of them. There's a number of human rights treaties within the OAS on racial discrimination and other things as well. But the United States and most other nations in the Americas refuse to sign these. So how do you enforce those human rights? The way that they're done by the commission is that they start with the charter, because the charter is a treaty. And in order to be a member of the Organization of American States, you have to abide by the charter. And so the charter is enforceable. Next slide. And so what the courts have, what the tribunals have been saying is that the charter, basically the implementation of the charter is through the American Declaration of the Rights and Duties of Man. So even though the declaration itself is not enforceable, it can be enforced through the charter as an expression of the charter itself. Next slide. And they've said that as well for the American Convention on Human Rights, is that when you're talking about a right of equality, a right of property, a right of effective remedy, those kinds of things that you find within the American Declaration, then how do you interpret those for the persons that are before the tribunal. And the tribunal then can look at the American Convention on Human Rights. So even though the United States, in the case that I'm speaking of, as well as in most of the other cases, there are cases involving the Garifunas, Quilombo of Brazil, the Garifunas of Honduras, and the Mayans of Belize, all of these, most of these cases involve situations where the successor colonial powers have refused to sign these human rights conventions. And so the way that the tribunal is able to effectively use these, and they even use draft conventions, they use the draft convention on the rights of indigenous peoples before it became law. So the way that they use these is they say, if we're going to look at property in regards to the collective interests of the peoples that are before us, then we need to look to those treaties, those laws that define those. And the American Convention on Human Rights is one of those treaties that define what do we mean by human rights. Next document. Next slide. And so another one is the American Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. They also look at the UN Declaration on the rights of the United States has not signed the American Declaration or implemented it anyway. And plus they say it's just a declaration. But you can use this declaration the same way you did the American Declaration on Rights and Duties of Man to interpret what the human rights are when they're applied to a specific situation. Next slide. So the violator does not have to have those human rights treaties in force to be able for the tribunal to be able to use them enforcing the one treaty that they are obligated to comply with, and that's the charter for the Organization of American States. So this is that's where we got jurisdiction and got our decision in the Onondaga case. Now it's at the merit stage, and about 6-8 months ago, we filed our merits brief. Goes to the next stage where the tribunal then makes a decision. They've already ruled that as a matter of law, that if we can prove the facts, there have been violations. So we're almost guaranteed a decision on the merits. In the merits brief, what we did is we put the context, those equal protection violation, the property violation, and the failure to provide an effective remedy. We put those within a broader context of colonial rule. Because we recognized, and I think this is the first case to ever do this. This is the first case where a nation, Native nation, has actually directly confronted a colonial power here in the United States, and that relationship, their domination of that relationship as a product of colonial rule. And that all of these violations are a direct result of that colonial relationship. So in the motion of reconsideration is actually in your miscibility is in there, the colonial. This is not the brief on the merits. I'm sorry, but I think the brief on the merits is in your materials, and in there we lay out that argument in terms of this colonial relationship. Next slide, as being the underlying violation. We're taking the position that the United States is a colonial empire. And it's not so much an empire outside that's claimed boundaries, but it's an empire over some 500 indigenous nations within the United States. Next slide. The product of that is that they have a domestic law of colonialism. Next slide. I think we all know what it is. That it's a successor colonial state. It succeeded to the colonial relationship of England and France, Spain, and Netherlands. Next slide. Or is it the Dutch? And what we recognized, and this is from Patrick Wolf, is that settler colonialism is not an event, it's a structure. So it becomes part of the structure of the colonial power, or the successor colonial power in this case. Next slide. And so it becomes implemented within their domestic law. So the federal Indian law is actually the anti-Indian law. Next slide. It's a law of colonial occupation. And so it has these three doctrines, which I won't go through, even though I will say that these same doctrines have been imported worldwide. So you see these doctrines, they'll be referring back to the early US cases that created this colonial law you'll see those same cases cited in Africa. You'll see them in Australia and Canada and other places where they have indigenous peoples. Next slide. And they're trying to limit their power. So it's a colonial, this domestic colonial law is lawfare. Next slide. It's used to conquer and control indigenous peoples. And Alex de Tocqueville had a great comment on this in 1835 when he was watching the removal of indigenous peoples. And he was saying, and I'll just go to the last quote, that it is impossible to destroy men with more respect for the laws of humanity because they did it, creating laws to do that, just as Hitler created laws, the Nuremberg laws, to justify what he did. Next slide. So we're attacking the colonial relationship as slow genocide. Next slide. And it's a matter of international law because we're talking about the relationship between nations. Colonial occupation is a matter of international law. Next slide. So you'll never see these arguments being able to be litigated within the colonial state, like the U.S. Supreme Court. I'll try to speed up through and go through these a little fast, but the early declaration of the UN General Assembly was this resolution 1514 in 1960, where they condemned colonialism and called for its immediate eradication from the face of the earth. And they talked about the colonial state responsibility to do that. Next slide. So these are some of the resolutions condemning colonialism. Next slide. And by the way, every year the UN General Assembly passes a resolution condemning colonialism and calling for its end. And one of the only nations of the world that has consistently voted against that resolution is the United States. And so you'll see these in implementing this colonial resolution on decolonization, you'll see it in the International Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. So it's actually, even though it's a declaration, it's been included within a treaty that is binding. And so you'll see that discussion of this in the Western Sahara case, which I mentioned earlier. You also see it in the Chagos Archipelago advisory opinion, which I mentioned earlier as well. Next slide. So again, so we have, colonialism has two hats. One is a political hat, which is the colonial domination, but it also has a racist hat. And that's why it's included within the International Convention on Racism. And it identifies colonialism as an act of racism. Next slide. And so there's been, the UN has called for the last four decades for the complete eradication of colonialism from the face of the earth. Next slide. And again, we're talking about collective rights. And it's basically the right of self-determination. One of the main human rights treaties on that is the ICCPR. Next slide. And here's where the convention on the ICER dimensions and adopts the UN Assembly resolution on colonialism as part of the treaty. Next slide. And so I mentioned earlier that indigenous peoples are the only peoples of the world that did not have the full panel of human rights. And that was until 2007. And when, after a 40-year struggle, the indigenous peoples were able to get the United Nations to adopt the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Next slide. And the main thing is that it guarantees, it doesn't really create any rights for indigenous peoples, but it simply says that indigenous peoples have the same rights, same human rights, as all other peoples of the world, that they're free and equal to all other peoples. It's a shame that they actually had to pass a declaration to state this, but that's what happened in 2007. Even so, even today, there's compromises. They're undermining some of this. Next slide. In order to preserve the collective relationship. So these are some of the collective human rights that are enjoyed by all peoples, as well as, and now supposedly by indigenous peoples. Next slide. And so these are rights that we are invoking within the internet, within in the Onondaga case that we have. So there's now there's also a discussion of, I just want to mention this, of a fourth generation arising out of cyberspace technology and so forth. I won't get into that, but I just wanted to alert that's in existence. Next slide. So these are the generation rights. Next slide. All right, I'm pretty much done, but I wanted to mention a couple other things that should be put within the context of collective rights and rights, human rights in general. Human rights are positive law. They're created by treaties, created by documents drafted by men. There's also another set of law that arises under natural law, and it's been perverted quite a bit. But there are fundamental rights that are existential rights. In other words, they exist as part of the human condition. And they're expressed as inalienable rights or fundamental rights. Among those are life, liberty, and equality. I mentioned earlier that for us human rights practitioners, one of the big problems we have is being able to actually use the human rights conventions that we have, because the offending power has refused to adopt and implement them. This is one way I encourage everyone to look at. I don't think there's enough discussion of fundamental rights. There is a body of law that even if you have not adopted a human rights document, you still have to obey fundamental rights, including life, liberty, and equality. And so violations of equality, like we see with in many of those cases that I mentioned earlier, liberty and so forth, as well as life or genocide, all of those, you do not need a treaty. You do not need the Genocide Convention for life. It is a fundamental right. And there's a body of law that enforces that. Next slide. And so the last one I'd mention is jus cogens. There's also, as we know, within customary international law, for those rights that are so well respected among the international community, they're not only part of the customary international law, but they're so fundamental that they become jus cogens, which is defined in the Vienna Convention on Treaties as norms from which no derogation is permitted. So you cannot make a law against it. So you could have a domestic law that is legal for slavery or even genocide, as they did in Germany, but it would not pass muster with international law, because they would violate jus cogens rights. So what I wanted to mention here, and the reason why I threw this in, is if you look at the merits brief that we filed in the Onondaga case, we make the collective human rights arguments, but we also make the fundamental rights and the jus cogens arguments as supplements to the human rights. And so human rights sometimes are talked in the sense of fundamental rights, but human rights are not fundamental rights. Fundamental rights exist separately of human rights. It's just that sometimes they're the same, just like the right to equality is a fundamental right, it's a human right, as well as it can be a civil right. So, but anyway, thank you very much, and be happy to answer questions. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Andy. So much material, really important material. Thanks for explaining the three generations of human rights, particularly collective rights, and then among collective rights, group rights, and people's rights, two sets of people's rights, fundamental rights, jus cogens, peremptory rules of international law, and interestingly as well, your cases before the Inter-American system. So thanks so much for that. Our final faculty member is Bill Bowring. Bill, go ahead.
Thank you very much. And thank you. Congratulations, Matri, for organizing the Academy so magnificently so far. And it's a great honor and pleasure to be here today with Andy, with Curtis. Where I wanted to start, just completing the introduction, perhaps, is that as a practitioner, I've taken a lot of cases to the European Court of Human Rights, in particular, right through the 1990s into the 20s, against Turkey on behalf of Kurds. And then from from 1998 onwards against Russia on behalf of Chechens. And as part of that, I've been arrested twice in Russia and deported, though, as you can see, I'm still alive. Though I will come back to why this is significant. It's because the European Convention on Human Rights, which has been briefly mentioned, covers 850 million people or so, and a very large number of countries. And it was the first such instrument with a court which is obligatory for the member states, from which Russia has now been expelled. And it's basically an 18th century document. And I will explain that further in a minute. It's because if you look at the 1789 Déclaration des droits de l'homme et du citoyen of the French Revolution, the European Convention on Human Rights is not quite word for word the same, but very close, including the right to private property. The cases on behalf of Kurds and Chechens are basically cases about people's rights, which Andy was talking about, and Curtis. And that means that on the face of it, there's no room in the European Convention on Human Rights for people's rights claims. However, there have been judgments in hundreds of cases now against Turkey and by Chechens against Russia. And of course, there were two Russian wars in Chechnya, first and second, and they were colonial wars. Chechnya was conquered by Russia in the 19th century. And Russia used methods very similar to the methods being used by Russia now in its imperial war in Ukraine. So how can one bring people's rights cases, collective right cases, to a body like the European Court of Human Rights? And by the way, the Council of Europe, of which the European Court of Human Rights is part, and the Convention, was the creation of no less than the imperialist Winston Churchill. And he founded it for two reasons. First of all, as an ideological counterpart to NATO in the Cold War, and I will come back to that, but also to prevent socialism in Britain. Because, of course, in 1945, at the end of World War II, Churchill suffered a crushing defeat by the Labour Party. And during the period before he returned to power in 1951, he wanted to put mechanisms in place to stop socialism in Britain. In what I say for the next 30 or 40 minutes is in part in answer to the questions which Curtis raised right at the beginning of his talk. Two questions he raised: whether the system is working, and what meaning does the system have for victims of human rights violations? So I will have those in mind. And of course, the question which has been raised by both Curtis and Andy is, what are human rights? Now, Marjorie promised you that I would give you a Marxist approach to these issues. And I'm speaking to you from England, where I was born, and I have British citizenship, but I'm really American. Both my parents were American. Most of my relatives were in the States. My mother was Dutch-American from the Midwest, and my father, English-American from California. So just to round that off, for the last 25 years, I've been married to a Russian who's now a British citizen as well as a Russian citizen. And she is, in fact, Tatar, who ruled Russia for several hundred years, so descendant of Genghis Khan. And my two younger children, aged 22 and 17, are both Russian citizens as well as British citizens. That was very good previously in order to visit the grandparents and relatives. So, of course, in America, Marxism are terms of abuse. And the worst thing that Trump could think of to describe Kamala Harris was that she, according to him, was a Marxist. Actually, she's not. So what did Marx have to say about rights and about human rights? And there are two texts which you can look at, they're readily available on the internet, at the beginning and at the end of his life, because he lived from 1818 to 1883. And the first was a text called On the Jewish Question, published in 1844 when Marx was 26 years old. And he was Jewish, of course, from a family of rabbis. The Jewish question is how Jews can become fully part of a civil society. But the text includes a blistering attack on the French Declaration of Rights of Man and a Citizen of 1789 and the American Bill of Rights, the 10 amendments to the Constitution of the United States of America, also from 1789. Ratified in 1791. And Marx, and I think Curtis foreshadowed this, said that actually those individual rights in the French Declaration and the American Bill of Rights are the rights to be a capitalist. So they are the rights to be left alone with your private property and the other rights set out. Of course, in the American Bill of Rights, it includes the right to bear arms, rights concerning militia, which are not in the French Declaration. But that was Marx's very strong attack. It's worth looking at. I think Marx would have had a different approach to social and economic rights and to people's and collective rights, but I'll come back to that. The second text was towards the end of his life, and that was called the Critique of the Goethe Program. And the Critique of the Goethe Program, 1875, was a critique of the first program of the German Social Democratic Party, where there were provisions on equal rights. And Marx said, equal rights is nonsense. People are not equal. A newly born baby is not equal to an elderly person at the end of her life. An able-bodied person is not equal to a disabled person. Up until the present day, women are absolutely not equal to men. So Marx said, actually, the question is not formal equality between people. And I think that is something to bear in mind. So what is, on that kind of basis, my approach to human rights? And I'm going to give you now another version of what Andy was talking about, which are the three generations of human rights, which was an idea developed by a chap called Vashak back in the 1960s, and which I find very, very useful for teaching. I follow a philosopher called Alistair MacIntyre, who's still alive, in his book called After Virtue. And what he is very clear about is that human rights are both geographically and temporarily located. That is, before the 18th century, it would have made absolutely no sense to talk about human rights. Nobody was talking about human rights, not even the rights of man, as in the French Declaration. So what McIntyre says, and I agree with him, is that if you talk about universal human rights, rights which belong to people by virtue of being human beings at all times and in all places, that is literally nonsense. And McIntyre goes on to say that, of course, you could have professors of witchcraft or unicorns and write books about them, but that does not mean that they exist. So with the three generations, I locate them in revolutionary events. For teaching purposes, I attach to them the three words of the slogan of the French Revolution, which in France you will still find on every school and every public building. Three words: liberté, liberty; égalité, equality; fraternité, brotherhood. Liberté, égalité, fraternité. And I attach colors to them just to make it easy for the students. So the first generation has the color blue, the second generation has the color red, and the third generation has the color green. So 1789, the French Revolution, the first generation of human rights, blue color, and liberté. And by the way, somebody we are very proud of in Britain was the author of Common Sense, one of the great texts of the American Revolution, and the Rights of Man, and in particular writing against the founder of English conservatism, Edmund Burke, who described the Declaration of the Rights of Man and the Citizen as high explosive, which will blow up all constitutional rights and liberties. And of course, I'm talking about Tom Paine. And so Tom Paine's book, Common Sense, was a very important text in America. And his book, The Rights of Man, is an attack on the English monarchy and aristocracy and all the feudal remnants in England. And it reads as if it was written today, as a matter of fact. It's an absolutely blistering attack on the opponents of the Declaration of 1789. So, second generation, égalité, equality, color red. And I date that from 1919, immediately following the Russian Revolution of 1917. And 1919 was the year of an organization which Andy was talking about, the International Labour Organization, created in 1919 as part of the League of Nations after the First World War. And the International Labour Organization is still there. If you, it's part of the United Nations now. If you go to Geneva, it's a huge building looking over the lake. It's unique because it is tripartite. It's everything the ILO does is government, business, and trade unions. And the ILO has more than 200 treaties on social and economic rights. And as Andy mentioned, a very important treaty, number 169, on the rights of indigenous peoples. So 1919, What was that? It was the response of the West to the great threat posed by the Russian Revolution. So 1919. Third generation. So Fraternité, color green. I date that to 1960. And that is in the struggle for decolonization. So that was an enormous battle all over the world, starting after the, even before the Second World War. But 1960 in particular, Andy already mentioned the UN Declaration on Rights of Peoples to Self-Determination from the United Nations, where a small group of colonial powers voted against. And I tell my students that they have to see the film by Pontecorvo, The Battle of Algiers. That is one of the best films ever on anti-colonial struggle. And of course, France treated Algeria as part of mainland France. I mention Marx and Engels in this context as well, because they were the first people to use the phrase right of nations to self-determination. They used it in the context of Irish struggle for freedom. And of course, Ireland only became free from England after a very bloody war of independence after the First World War in the 20th century. And so Marx and Engels were very strong supporters of Irish liberation. They also applied the phrase to Poland, which had been divided up between the Russian Empire, the Prussian Empire, and the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and ceased to exist. And Warsaw was a city in the Russian Empire. So Marx and Engels hated the Russian Empire and fought for the right to self-determination of Poland. They also came out very strongly for the Union in the American Civil War, and wrote a lot about that, but equally about Algeria and other French colonial possessions, and in particular, the Indian uprising, which the British still called the Indian Mutiny, which was put down with fantastic bloodshed. I mean, England's record in India, including 3 million Bengalis sentenced to starvation by Winston Churchill during World War II, for example, but it's history absolutely dripping with blood. And Marx and Engels were very much involved in that. So three generations. And as I say, the European Convention on Human Rights, although it's a document from after the Second World War, is very much an 18th century document. So what relevance does it have to the cases which I'm taking, I have been taking on behalf of Kurds against Turkey and on behalf of Chechens against Russia? Well, here I draw from the great American professor of law, Patricia Williams, who wrote that these old documents take on a new life in struggle. And if you like, the revolutionary fire that burnt in them originally comes back to life in the struggles of the peoples of the Kurdish and Chechen peoples. I just add at this point that I don't believe that law is emancipatory. I'm sorry about that. Nor do I believe that taking cases to, let's say, the European Court of Human Rights actually solves anything for those peoples. I think it's something which lawyers can and should do, and there is a mechanism there. So was taking cases for the Kurds or the Chechens a waste of time? Absolutely not. And for the victims concerned, I mean, the first cases I took against Russia was when Putin invaded Chechnya in the second Chechen War in 1999. And the first thing which he did, revenge for the Chechens having won the first Chechen war 4 years previously, was to entirely demolish the city of Grozny, the capital of Chechnya. And my cases were women who'd gone to a green route, a safe route. This has echoes of Gaza, by the way. Safe route out of Grozny into neighboring Ingushetia. And on the day in question, there were thousands of vehicles, including my clients and the Red Cross. And the Russians bombed it. And that, my client's children were killed. Russia denied it, of course. And we got a very, very good judgment from the European Court of Human Rights, which we had translated into Russian and distributed all over Russia, telling the truth of what had happened to my clients, their children, and many other people. My clients could not get their children back. Money doesn't compensate for the loss of your children. What they wanted was the truth of what had happened to them. And my last case to be cited against Russia in 2021, before Russia was expelled, was the case of the widow of Alexander Litvinenko, who was murdered with radioactive poison in London in 2006. And it took 14 years. European Court of Human Rights is not quick at the best of times, 5 or 6 years. It took 14 years this time. But in 2021, I got a finding of murder by Putin and the Russian regime. It has to be proved beyond reasonable doubt. The court prefers to find some procedural failing, but they found violations of the right to life and the right to be free from torture in that case. So is it worth doing? Yes, I think it is. So just to expand a little bit on the question of the UDHR and the covenants, because that is what Marjorie directed us to look at in particular. And these are the two covenants on civil and political rights and economic, social and cultural rights. So I think it's worth bearing in mind that the UDHR, and indeed the foundation of the United Nations, was at the end of the Second World War. It was the victors. And the members of the permanent members of the Security Council to this day are the winning side in World War II, including Russia as the successor of the USSR. And what was the Universal Declaration of Human Rights? Well, it's been mentioned quite correctly that it includes, to some extent, both first and second generation rights. However, this was still in the context of a world which was mostly still under colonial oppression. And I saw in the chat, one of our colleagues who's attending at the moment mentioned, what about American colonies? What about Puerto Rico, which is a commonwealth with no rights under the American Constitution? What about Hawaii, which is a colonial possession? What about the present state of the Philippines, which is still effectively an American colonial possession? Andy mentioned the Chagos Islanders case, where Britain was found to have violated the right to self-determination of Mauritius at the time of granting independence. And of course, Diego Garcia has become the main American point. It's part of the British Indian Ocean Territory, so-called, but it's American, a place where waterboarding and rendition take place on the way to Guantanamo. So the beginnings of the United Nations and of the UDHR were in colonialism. Latin America had already, through Bolivar and those movements, become free from Spain and Portugal. But of course, America has been the hegemon in Latin America ever since, and right up until the 80s, the United States was supporting military dictatorships throughout South America. And look what's happened to Cuba, and it's still happening at this present time. So the intention was in 1948 that the UDHR, which has already mentioned, is not a legally binding treaty, but it does have the force of customary international law. The intention was that it would become quickly a binding treaty. What was the reason that couldn't happen? The reason was the Cold War. The Soviet Union, the constitutions of Stalin, 1936, and Brezhnev, 1978, had chapters on human rights. But the number one right in the Soviet Union and its allies was the right to work. And indeed, it was a crime in the Soviet Union not to have a job. So the Soviet Union could say, we are actually implementing this right in our constitution. And the other rights were rights to a pension, to social security, to free healthcare, to free education, to housing. All of those social and economic rights, the Soviet Union could say, yes, that is what we are doing our best to implement. Then you come to the right of freedom of expression. That said, everyone has the right to freedom of expression, providing it's exercised in the interests of the working class. Basically, you had no freedom of expression in the Soviet Union. Same thing with freedom of association. Everyone had the right of freedom of association, providing it was exercised in the interests of the working class. So what was the West? I already mentioned the origins of the European Convention on Human Rights. The West, United States, United Kingdom, Western European countries, insisted that the most important rights were the first generation rights, which you find in the European Convention. So there was an absolute divide. And it wasn't until 1966, so many years after the UDHR, that it was possible for two covenants to be drafted. The Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which the West understood to be the only justiciable rights, the only rights you could bring before a court, and the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, which the West understood to be non-justiciable. That is not what it says in the Covenant, by the way. And one of the texts which you're going to have available to you is what I've written about this history and the very intense negotiations taking place within the United Nations. And Article number one, this has not been mentioned so far this evening. Article one, common first article of both covenants, ICCPR and ICSCR, is the right of peoples to self-determination. In the same, now that, in my view, was a major achievement of the Soviet Union, even though it was totally hypocritical. Because as far as the Soviet Union was concerned, it did not apply within the Soviet Union. However, this was actually, if you have a look at President Putin's speech on immediately before the latest all-out invasion of Ukraine, he doesn't talk about NATO, he talks about Lenin, because Vladimir Lenin applied Marx or Engels's policy on self-determination to the Russian Empire and Poland, Finland, the three Baltic states all became independent after the Russian Revolution. Georgia would have become independent, but that was the last big battle between Lenin and Stalin. And Lenin was in favor of the complete breakup of the former Russian Empire. And as far as Lenin was concerned, this applied to all colonial empires. And the first constitution of the USSR, drafted by Lenin, has the right to self-determination, a federative principle, and the 15 union republics of the USSR had the constitutional right to secede, which they couldn't exercise until 1991. But nonetheless, Putin describes Lenin as a German agent who destroyed the Russian Empire and through the federative structure put an atomic bomb under the USSR. Putin hates the USSR because in 1945, with the foundation of the UN, Ukraine and Belarus were both founding members of the UN as union republics of the USSR with their own seats on the General Assembly. Putin says Ukraine doesn't exist and never existed. And this was the crime of Lenin and of his theory and practice of self-determination. So the two covenants are absolutely the product of the Cold War. And Marjorie, how much time do I have left, if any?
I would say maybe 10 or 15 minutes.
Oh, right. Okay. I thought I'd already gone on too long. So you cannot, in my opinion, understand the two covenants without seeing that they both have common Article 1 on the right of people's self-determination. That is still absolutely explosive. And that's why it's so cool that Andy mentioned the Chagos Islanders case, condemning the United Kingdom and actually followed by a General Assembly resolution that the United Kingdom should get the hell out of the Chagos Islands. And the newest British colony, the British Indian Ocean Territory, was created in the 1960s. So, and absolutely explosive in the context of Israel and Palestine. And the latest advisory opinion of the International Court of Justice on the illegality of Israel's continued occupation after since 1967, absolutely legal, and annexation, because what is now taking place in Gaza and the West Bank in particular, is the wholesale annexation of occupied territory. It could not be greater illegality. And this is happening in real time before our eyes. I've been going to Israel and Palestine since 1988, time of the First Intifada, many times, three times to Gaza. And what's happening absolutely relentlessly is apartheid in the West Bank, where it's carved up by 300 settlements, illegal settlements, roads on which only settlers can travel, and freedom for settlers to use extreme violence against Palestinians to drive them off their land. So I've written quite a lot about this and push this as much as I can. And of course, in the United Kingdom now, I'm sitting in England, in a part of England which after the Ice Age was Celtic, then it was Roman Empire for hundreds of years. And then it was settled by Saxons from Germany, and they're the basic white population now. Then it was ruled by Denmark for a long period of time, and then conquered by the Normans from France. And so we had French-speaking monarchs and aristocrats for hundreds of years after 1066. That's England. There's so-called United Kingdom. What is the United Kingdom? Well, first of all, Wales, which is Celtic speaking, was ravaged by the English, and the Normans put castles all over Wales to keep the population down. There was a real attempt to eliminate the Welsh language. And Scotland was an independent kingdom, often at war with England. And there was an act of union between England and Scotland. So between two sovereign states. Scotland, by the way, kept its own legal system, completely different from the English one, much closer to the French. Its own education system, completely different from in England. Students have to borrow £9,250 a year to study at university. In Scotland, it's free of charge for the Scots and their own money, actually. So in my opinion, Scotland has a perfect right to leave. England, of course, does everything it can to put obstacles in the way. And the last referendum was not successful. Scottish National Party is in terrible crisis. But in my opinion, Scotland will become independent. And actually, Britain, as a result of leaving the EU, is now 15% poorer. The Republic of Ireland, as I said, became independent after a very bloody war of independence from England against the whole British Empire after the First World War, is now 15% better off than England for the first time in history. That's because they do very well within the European Union. Scotland says, well, you know, EU is a good place for small countries to thrive and prosper. And recently, I've been to both Dublin and Belfast for a huge conference in Dublin called Ireland's Future. And there's now a bullet train between Dublin and Belfast. You can do it very quickly, very reasonably priced. As you know, there is no physical border between Northern Ireland and the Republic. The Catholic Church has been definitively defeated in the Republic of Ireland, and Protestant Unionists are now in a minority in Northern Ireland, where the government is Sinn Féin, which is increasingly important in the Republic of Ireland. So, in my opinion, I think Ireland will unify within my lifetime. And why do I say that? Because from 1969 until 1988, there was a horrible war in Northern Ireland, as we know, with a lot of people killed and also bombing. One bomb nearly took my daughter in London, in Victoria Station. 30 people were killed during that period. And peace in Northern Ireland, which the United States, well, there's a huge Irish population, helped with. The Good Friday Agreement, which is an international treaty, declares the right of the people of the island of Ireland to self-determination. Britain resisted that for a long time, but there it is. It's in the treaty. And this is one of the reasons there's been such problems with Brexit, as a matter of fact. And so Britain, once there is a majority in the north for reunification with the south, Britain cannot stand in its way. So Scotland will become independent, I'm sure. Wales has its own government now since devolution. During the last years, it's had a Labour government and still does. And the language is really coming back in Wales. And so I think there will be a significant movement in Wales for independence. Then England will be left and we'll have to decide about becoming a normal middle-sized European country. We are not located anywhere near the United States. And I don't think the United States wants us as the 51st state. The best we would get is to become a Commonwealth like Puerto Rico, I'm afraid to say. So England, so I conclude my remarks, Marjorie, saying this. I'm 10 years older than Curtis, heaven help me. So I've been around for quite a long time. And during my lifetime, we have the former Yugoslavia. We have the former USSR. We have the former East Germany, which I got to know quite well before it was swallowed up by West Germany. And in the future, we will have the former UK, or F-U-K, or fuck. And then we will have to get used to being a normal European country. We still have horrible delusions of empire, by the way. Boris Johnson, who is an imperialist, really thought that the white dominions, you know, these countries, Australia and New Zealand, which still have a British flag in their corner, Canada, which still has the British monarch, the white dominions, so somebody in the chat, I couldn't read it, but just mentioned Canada. Canada actually is a good guy country, relatively speaking, in relation to its indigenous peoples, but still subject to the British Crown, with a significant, I mean, somebody mentioned minority rights, but self-determination, the state of the art on the right of people's self-determination is the decision, is the judgment of the Canadian Supreme Court on secession of Quebec. Who is particularly opposed to the secession of Quebec? It's the native Canadians, by the way. So, but Canada, and exactly, thank you, Jan, you are right. Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, how come they are white? Well, it was on the basis of the elimination or attempted elimination of the indigenous peoples in Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. And that's why the so-called white dominions had special status within the British Empire. South Africa, which was handed over by Britain to apartheid. So British Empire, the empire on which the blood never dried, as has been aptly said. So not as horrendous, I say, to Nicole as UK. It is, UK is absolutely complicit in genocide, and our new prime minister is a Zionist. I'm proud of it. And the majority of members of the new Labour government are members of Labour Friends of Israel and have all expenses paid junkets to Israel, etc. So I saw it out of the corner of my eye. So anyway, thank you for your attention. And I hope what I've said made some kind of sense. And I look forward to any questions if there are.
Well, thank you, Bill, for that provocative analysis of international human rights law in the context of political history, dripping with blood, to quote you, and consistent with your distinction between the two different sets of human rights. The United States has ratified the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, refuses to ratify the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights because of...
But only in 1992, and of course, what held the United States up was execution of children.
Well, that was the Convention on the Rights of the Child, but the provision...
As well, but also in the ICCPR, that there was so many horrendous continuing violations.
What I was going to say is that in the ICESCR, the things that you mentioned were too closely akin to socialism for power structure. At any rate, let's move on. And I have a few initial comments to throw out to the faculty, and then we have some questions from our participants. First of all, I just wanted to clarify signatory versus party to a treaty. When a country signs a treaty, that's an intent to ratify under the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties. It's not supposed to take action inconsistent with the object and purpose of the treaty. But until it ratifies or accedes to the treaty, it doesn't really become a party with all of the obligations on the international plane. So Andy mentioned the Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. That is a treaty body that administers the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. The Convention Against Torture has the Committee Against Torture. The ICCPR has the Human Rights Committee. And when a country becomes a party to a treaty, generally through ratification, it has a duty to report periodically on its progress in fulfilling its obligations under the treaty. And treaty bodies review those reports, also collect other information from NGOs and other bodies, and interpret the treaty provisions. Andy, doesn't the Supreme Court, U.S. Supreme Court's jurisprudence on affirmative action violate the ICCPR and the Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination for its failure to take affirmative action to remedy racial inequality? And Bill, wouldn't Marx, you said that Marx didn't think that all people were equal, so that would say to me that he would favor affirmative action. And I think that those were my comments or questions, if people want to comment on them.
Well, on the affirmative action example, yes, of course. It's a violation of international law. It's a clear violation. The problem you have is that the U.S. refuses to recognize international law, international human rights law, or collective rights. And so until that changes, the United States will be an outlier on that. And the sad part about it, and it's what you've noted, is that the United States has signed and ratified the International Convention on the Elimination of Ethnic and Racial Discrimination, for example, and civil and political rights. It refuses to ratify the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Political Rights because it doesn't want to recognize, it's a capitalist society, and the last thing it wants to do is recognize economic rights. And so it will never sign that. But yes, you're definitely correct. It's so that, but your remedy obviously will not be in a US court system that self-defines its rights that it has to enforce. It has to come outside. And the one thing I will note, and a lot of people don't recognize this, the United States has been sued many times for human rights violations, many, many times. There's even a European Court on Human Rights decision regarding refoulement and the black sites and so forth of arising out of the war on terror as being violated by the United States. There's probably 10 or more decisions in the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights finding the United States has violated the human rights of many people, everything from the death penalty, execution of children, and the rights of a number of status rights, as well as four or five decisions, well, actually two or three now, on indigenous people. So yeah, the problem isn't whether or not it's a violation of human rights, affirmative action decisions. The issue is a political one, whether or not we're going to be able to hold the United States to that. And that's where I wanted to tie in what you just said, Marjorie, about the Vienna Convention. The United States has signed some of these human rights conventions. And by signing it under the Vienna Convention, which is what the United States has not signed, by the way, or ratified, but is part of the customary international law now, under the Vienna Treaty on Conventions, Convention on Treaties, you cannot act in derogation of a treaty that you've signed, and even if it hasn't been ratified or implemented. So one other comment I wanted to make on that, in the litigation that we've had between the United States and indigenous peoples, and they do show up and they make their arguments in the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. A lot of times the United States doesn't even respond, but they have on these cases. And what they say is that the UN, that the American Constitution and the Bill of Rights are equal to the human rights conventions, and that it satisfies all its human rights obligations by enforcing the Constitution's Bill of Rights. That's the persistent response that the United States has to these human rights violations. So I don't know if that answers your question, but it's more of a political one than a legal one.
Right, because of course the U.S. Constitution has something called the Supremacy Clause, which says treaties shall be the supreme land and they shall be given the same effect as federal statutes. But then I think it was John Marshall who first came up with this cockamamie theory of executing versus non-self-executing treaties, so that you can ratify a treaty, but it doesn't really mean that you have obligations under the treaty unless, this is a U.S. position, unless Congress executes or implements it by passing legislation. And the U.S. has passed legislation to execute the torture convention, but not the ICCPR or the race convention. Bill.
Yeah, Bill. Just 3 points, please, arising from what you've both been saying. First of all, in the United Kingdom, we are also dualist. So we have the position where Britain ratified the European Convention on Human Rights in 1953. We didn't allow anyone to bring a complaint until 1966. And that was because of the empire. And the first cases were to do with British atrocities in Cyprus, to do with discrimination against the East African Asians, which we lost, and to do with torture in Northern Ireland. And it didn't become part of our domestic law until the year 2000. So I started practicing as a barrister in 1975. I could not mention the European Convention on Human Rights because it was not part of our law. So if you wanted to go to Strasbourg, you had to go all the way through the UK, the English courts, 5 years, probably at least, then another 5 years in Strasbourg. All of the main cases of the European Court of Human Rights on fundamental issues are cases against the UK, right up until the year 2000. And of course, there's been, I have an article I'll send to anyone who's interested called English Terror of the French Revolution. And ever since Edmund Burke and Tom Paine, the British state has hated the idea of rights set out in a document. As I say, Churchill only went that way for political reasons. And many people in the Conservative Party in Britain want us to leave the European Convention on Human Rights. Theresa May called it a terrorist charter. So, second point, briefly. I think it's worth noticing that all of the common law countries, so that's Britain, United States, which is based on common law principles, and Australia, New Zealand, Canada to an extent, are totally allergic to social and economic rights. So far as the common law countries are concerned, social and economic rights do not exist. And that is Britain's position, and it's the United States position. You know, so there you see the unity of the common law countries. Many people don't know, except for my students, that the Council of Europe has a European Social Charter with the European Committee on Social Rights. And since the last years, there's a revised Social Charter giving a right of collective complaint, that is by trade unions, NGOs, to the European Committee on Social Rights. And there have been many important judgments which are implemented by the countries against which they're brought. They're all southern European countries, but including France, very important cases on Roma, for example, involved. Britain refuses to have anything to do with it, of course, because so far as we're concerned, like the United States, social and economic rights do not exist.
Curtis, did you want to weigh in?
Maybe just to point out a few things. Andrew mentioned the fact that the United States, and you mentioned too, I think, that the United States often has this difference between treaties that are self-executing and not self-executing. It also has a difference between, of course, executive agreements and treaties. And I was involved in a dispute on this during the Paris Agreement, which I was very much involved in advising members of the G77 on this, where the United States, John Kerry, then the United States representative, the Paris Agreement is a climate agreement. He represented to the world that the U.S., false pretenses, got concessions from countries by saying that for the United States to adhere to this treaty and to be bound by this treaty, we need these concessions. When, as we knew at that time, there was no chance that the Senate would approve that treaty. And he essentially said to other states that the United States was bound by that treaty when it has never been a treaty for the United States. Even now, as they have agreed to it as an executive agreement, it will never be ratified by the United States. And I would suggest that this violates another provision of the Vienna Convention, and that is the provision that you must negotiate a treaty in good faith. When you're negotiating a treaty knowing that you will never be, under international law, bound by it because it has not gone through the ratification procedures, you are not negotiating in good faith. Just that short little quip. Mm-hmm.
Bill, did you want to mention something, or you were just agreeing?
No, I'm just applauding what Kurt has just said.
Okay. Do any of you have any comments or questions on each other's presentations that you'd like to mention before we move to the questions Q&A from the participants?
Well, I think it worked really nicely, by the way, and the order in which we came. And so each one of us supplemented the other, I think.
Yes.
I could not think of any disagreements, actually, fundamentally.
I have some questions, if I may, one for Bill, one for Andy, if I may. Very quick questions. For Bill, do you think that our existing human rights mechanisms address the structural causes of human rights violations? Are they sufficient to do that, do you think? And for Andy?
Sorry, I'll wait for your other question.
Okay.
Sorry.
For Andy, just a very quick one. Are the Palestinians a peoples? Maybe Bill.
Shall I go first? Just to answer your question to Andy. Of course there are people. This has been, you know, if there's any people, you know, I can think of, I do a lot of work with the Catalans and the Basques at the moment. They are both peoples, you know. And although international law does not contain a definition, as we all know, of what a people is, I think we know a people when we see one. And the Palestinians, that's been confirmed at the highest level. Has it not, you know, by the International Court of Justice, so nobody can dispute. So what was your first question again? So I'm not, as you can see, I have a materialist approach to human rights. And I think that you can only understand, in my personal view, understand them as documents emerging in revolutionary periods historically at a particular time and place, with all the limitations that mean. Does that mean that these are mechanisms which it's not worth trying to do something with? Of course. But I would insist that, as I pointed out in relation to the Kurds and the Chechens, taking cases never changes the world and has never changed the world. And by the way, just to add, that Marx and Engels were very clear that there could not be socialist law, nor could there be a socialist theory of law, but the workers take up legal demands and must do. So in Marx and Engels' time, the struggle for the 10-hour day was a legal struggle. And of course the workers had to take it up. And I would say to Andy, of course the indigenous peoples have to take up legal struggles. I think it's really important. And I think that even if it doesn't change the world, I think it has a big effect on the struggle overall, by the way, which is what I was trying to say about the Kurds and the Chechens. So I do not believe in human rights as a new religion, absolutely not. However, I think particularly if we have the misfortune to be lawyers, And I do remember Ramsey Clark saying at a conference I went to years ago at Hunter College that we lawyers are closer to the devil.
I just want to follow up with one quick thing and then move to Andy about the question about Palestinians being peoples. The law is not a panacea. And I think that, you know, as lawyers, we get this all the time. We must support people's struggles and take guidance from them. But I remember in the 60s, we used to say one struggle, many fronts. And the courtroom is another front. And the Palestinians use the ICC, they pressure around the ICC, they cite the ICJ opinion, they organize around it. So I think the law is important, although we should have no illusions about how powerful it really is. Andy?
I think we're in agreement, Marjorie.
Yeah, I just finished a book. I think it's called 100 Years of War on the Palestinian Struggle. I can't remember if that's the exact title. But it goes from the Balfour Declaration to the present day, and it tracks the entire displacement, the elimination of the Palestinian people to make room for the Zionists. And it tracks almost event by event, day by day, law by law, the elimination of native people from their lands around the world. So they are definitely have a common situation with native genocide and native ethnic cleansing. It's essentially ethnic cleansing. And in terms of whether or not they can qualify as a people, the answer to this is definitely yes. And I've had discussions I've had students in my class that are Zionists, and they want to argue that the Palestinians are not peoples and so forth. That's a very suspect argument. For one, peoples is the basic rule of peoples is that it's self-defining within certain limits. There's certain qualifications for what a peoples are in terms of indigenous people. Well, there's two questions. One is whether they're peoples, number one, and one is whether they're indigenous peoples. And both of those questions have been raised in terms of the Palestinians. But anyway, indigenous peoples is self-defining. The only qualifications is that you generally have to be subjected to some kind of colonial rule, and that you have a separate identity or attachment to the earth. You have a separate relationship to the lands that you exist on. But in terms of peoples, that's for indigenous. In terms of peoples, peoples are defined under international law, and it's a shared culture, shared language, shared identity, and so forth. I understand that there are different groups of Palestinians. The best answer I would have for that is read Western Sahara. And then I think it clearly answers whether or not the Palestinians, you know, you have an issue, are the Bedouin peoples. Clearly the Bedouin are peoples. So you might be able to break up the Palestinians into some of the different ethnic groups and argue that they are different peoples, but they can come together as a group and make a peoples. One thing I wanted to comment on this, and that is something I wanted to make earlier to those that are listening, is for those of us who practice in the United States, we know that law is very static. It's hard law. It doesn't change. You can't evolve. They always go back to see what the original intent was and so forth. And it's hell. It's legal hell to work with in terms of trying to create social change. International law has, and there's some great discussions on this in the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, particularly in terms of the indigenous people's rights. International law is fluid. It's always changing, and it adapts to the current situation. So you have a right of property, which was considered an individual property right under John Locke for capitalist accumulation and so forth. That was in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It was meant to deal with individual property accumulation to support capitalist societies. That has been expanded now. If you look at the right to property as a collective right, it's gone from an individual right supporting capitalism to being a collective right that defeats capitalism. And because it's been reinterpreted within the context of a communal interest or a community interest in that. And we're seeing that happening again with the rights of so-called rights of nature, which I don't believe in. But also within the trust public trust and other collective concepts of property. And so we're having a complete revision of not only concepts of property, but concepts of equality, as well as concepts of liberty. And those are not concepts, they're completely different than how they were in 1948. So that's, and so I see that happening as well with Palestine and other places, is if it walks like a duck, sounds like a duck, it's a duck, and the Palestinians are our peoples.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to move on to the questions now from our participants. I'm going to basically throw out three of them, and then any of the faculty can respond to any parts of them. The first one, I think, though, is directed to Curtis. What about CELAC, and you might want to define what CELAC is, as an alternative to human rights mechanisms under the OAS, which is the Organization of American States, and the Inter-American Convention on Human Rights? How do collective rights relate to minority and women's rights? And can G77 in China and BRICS, we can define BRICS, control genocide by not participating? That's one question Curtis may want to take on. And then a second question is, what about the rights of investors and corporations under the WTO, the World Trade Organization, and ISDS, not sure what that is, treaties, in favor of corporations and against states that recognize collective rights? And then the third question is, how does the colonial structure of international law impact criminal versus civil remedies? Will we see progress in getting remedies for generational victims of mass atrocities before there are actual treaties on the subject? So I want to open up to the faculty to deal with those issues. Curtis, I think you did respond in the chat to that question, but you may want to just say a few words about it, the first question about CELAC.
Well, first, CELAC is the Community of Latin American and Caribbean States. It's it was initiated by the more, you might say, socialist states of South America, the more activist states of South America. And it doesn't have its own human rights mechanisms, as far as I know. I'd be willing to be corrected on that. I deal with their diplomats regularly, but I'm not familiar with a existing human rights system, but it is intended to be an alternative very much to the United Nations. And it's part of what I think is right now the weakening structure of some of these, maybe you'd say, Western created organizations and the alternatives that the Global South is looking for to either replace or and somehow deal with these organizations. BRICS is one of those. The BRICS just stands for the abbreviation of the states that are members of that, although those states have now been greatly enlarged. But of course, it's Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. But now Iran is going to possibly join, several states from South America, other states from Africa may join, including Nigeria. So it is also being created as a sort of alternative, more in the, at this moment, in the economic sphere, but certainly also in the political sphere. And the G77 is a group of 134 states in China, a group that I've advised in several international forums, including I'm here in New York right now for that purpose, in part. We just had a resolution on Palestine adopted yesterday. And part of the problem was that some of these Global South states that are members of the G77, which are not any longer 77 states, but 134 states plus China, are, put it kindly, pressured to abide by the interest of the Global North instead of the Global South. And it takes quite a lot of organization to try to convince them to what I would see as do the right thing and act in their interests and the interests of other states from the Global South. That's a very, I read the question, it's the only one I'll address because I don't want to take too much time of the others on this. This question that asks about intertemporality, crimes against humanity and restitution. I just want to comment on that. I don't like to give too much my own opinion, but I like to comment on what other opinions are out there. That certainly this issue of intertemporality is a very important issue, an issue growing very much in the Global South, and particularly among the youth, both of the Global South and the Global North. It's a issue of intergenerational rights. And we will see more, I think, coming out on that, particularly in relation to, for example, the advisory opinion of the ICJ and the advisory opinion of the Inter-American Commission on Climate Change. I think they will make strong comments on that. And we have seen it already. We have seen some somewhat cowardly decisions by the Human Rights Committee and by even the CRC, but where they have recognized the rights of future generations to be affected, but have been unwilling to solidify them, if you will, or substantiate violations of those rights. Crimes against humanity, I think the question there being asked, if I understand it correctly, is how is it evolving? And I think we see part of that in the case concerning Myanmar in Asia and the Rwanda refugees there, and the fact that the International Court of Justice and the ICC, the International Criminal Court, are considering that issue. And as some of you may know that are participating, I'm sure Bill and Andrew know that the International Criminal Court also has on its agenda to consider the crime of ecocide. So crimes against humanity are certainly evolving, and I would say at a fairly rapid pace, considering our usual history. I mean, we didn't have Twitter and the internet and all, but compared to how international law has evolved in the past. And lastly, restitution. As you know, that was probably one of the main issues raised under the former president of the General Assembly that came from the Caribbean. And it is certainly an issue that the Caribbean countries, the Commonwealth, knows that very well. Have raised with in various international forums, and it is becoming an issue not only of lege ferenda, but I think an issue of at least political gravity that has to be addressed now by many of the countries that have acted in ways, thinking of slavery particularly, that have that accrue reparations to the victims of their actions.
Bill or Andy, do you want to respond to any of these?
I think Curtis has said everything.
Okay. And Andy? No.
Yeah, there's a couple of questions. On the ISDS, the commercial activities and the claim for damages when the human rights of peoples from the extractive industries and so forth are being protected. In the WTO, I've handled a case before the WTO. It's an interesting entity. Those are basically contract disputes, and the contract can be between a nation and a company, and there's a breach of contract and then damages. That should never undermine the human rights of peoples that are impacted by the extractive industries. And so I think that's what we're seeing. The problem we have is that a lot of these nations are entering into bad contracts. And so it's an issue of, and I'm not sure how, maybe that's a developing area of international law, would be how much, how to protect the less powerful nations from being exploited. We saw that in Nigeria, for example, with the Ogonis, and that the corporations through contracts with the governments can basically undermine the human rights and the welfare of their own people. And so how do we deal with that? Are we going to compound that by demanding that the nations pay amounts that are actually larger than the national budget, which I think was the case in Honduras or Guatemala, if I remember right, in one of those cases. So it's an area of law that needs to get developed. And in that one area that I know that we do have is that there are actually now new commercial communities being created, expat communities that were whole parts of indigenous territories being taken in Latin America for expat communities, where they actually under the arrangements that they have with the governments where they're located, they're actually given separate governance. So essentially have a corporations acting as municipalities or whatever with their own laws and so forth. And that creates a whole new area of abuse. On the UN drip, there's a question about the UN drip applying to the descendants of the African diaspora. The UN drip would apply to the indigenous peoples of Africa. So they would have UN drip claims to the diaspora, the taking of their citizens, other peoples into slavery. I will comment that a lot of the African nations actually participated in that as well. Although they, it's certainly not acceptable. I mentioned in the chat, and I'll just say it real quickly, as I represent the United Maroons Indigenous Peoples, and those are Maroons communities throughout the Americas that are surviving African communities. And so we're making the argument, and I have a book chapter coming out on this, we're making the argument that the Maroon communities in Jamaica, Trinidad, there's some in the United States, the Colombos in Brazil, and they're elsewhere. These are where they've kept their African culture and they kept their African spirituality and language and African ways, that they're actually African, indigenous African communities within the Americas. And so we're using the UN drip to protect them, UN Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. So that's one way that the descendants of the African diaspora, for those that don't know this, I'm sorry I'm speaking so fast for the interpreters, I apologize. But for those that don't know this, the Maroons are the slaves that escaped from slavery once they were brought over here. And they ran into the isolated areas, usually the jungle, and created their own communities that were basically left untouched for hundreds of years. The Saramaca case that I mentioned earlier is one of those. And their human rights to their land, to their territory, as against the exploitative industries was affirmed in that case by the Inter-American Court on Human Rights.
So I think we're going to have to leave it there. I want to thank Curtis and Bill and Andy for your excellent presentations, Charlotte Cates for all of her help, the interpreters and the People's Academy Task Force that meets every 2 weeks for the last 3 years to make this happen. Our October programs will be Course 5B, which is a continuation of these topics, and Seminar D, which is the Crisis of Public International Law, the Case of Palestine, and Impunity for Genocide. We will announce the date soon. We'll send you an email and also post it on our website. See you all next month.
Thank you. Bill, you have a minute to stay online?
I do.